Hello, dear tea friends from around the world, and welcome to a new Chashi lesson with me, Stefan Haller, from the Tea Masters blog. Now, yesterday we did a very interesting Chashi from the Qing Dynasty, Kung Fu Cha, from the Chaozhou era. And this time I thought let's go back even further in time. Let's go way back in time to the Song Dynasty. That's roughly 1000 years ago. And during the Song Dynasty, of course, the Chinese were drinking tea already, but in a different way than what we are doing nowadays. They were drinking green tea, but powdered. And different from the previous Tang Dynasty, they stopped boiling it. They were simply brewing and whisking it. And maybe you know this kind of preparation still done in Japan, the matcha ceremony. Now the Song Chinese, they were not really doing it as a ceremony, but as a tea preparation to have tea, more simply. And we have to go back a bit in their mood. 1000 years ago, the Song Dynasty, they were very austere Confucian society, where the emperor had a strong position. He liked very often the arts. The Song Huizong emperor, who also wrote a tea treatise, he also invented his own calligraphy style. So they were very much into arts. It's probably one of the most culturally advanced Chinese dynasty of them all, which means actually they neglected a bit making war, which is why this led to their downfall later on. But in terms of enjoying the arts, enjoying the fine life, especially 1000 years ago, you remember Europe was in the Middle Ages, in the US, in the Americas, there were just some Indians, Incas, and some buffaloes running around. While they were doing pyramids in Casa, but still nothing the like what the Chinese were doing at that time. Very well organized state with a few mandarins, public servants who were very selected according to very difficult criteria, and all to enjoy their time they were into making tea. Now, it's only in the 16th century that the Japanese started their matcha school, and thanks to them we have preserved these traditions. But the Song Dynasty, they were preparing tea a bit different. So I'm not going to make matcha the Japanese way, but the Chinese way, and I believe this is the very first time this is happening on Facebook Live, not only just on my page but anywhere. You can quickly Google Song Dynasty style tea, original Chinese Song Dynasty style tea. You won't find a video of how it's done in the entire Facebook or YouTube universe. Well, how do we start? My water has already boiled very recently, so I'm going first to add it to my ever. Warm it later on. Now that I've done this, I'm going to preheat my bowl. Okay, in theory I should not talk, and I won't during the preparation. This is one way to relax and to start imagine how you're going to brew. Just the same way as we are preheating our teapots and teacups. This is a time of being a bit more silent. Very important to well preheat the bowl. Now the bowl I'm using is a Zhenyang black glazed bowl from Fujian, from Zhenyang. I'm also preheating my whisk, my bamboo whisk, to avoid breaking the bamboo while I'm whisking it later on. Make sure it's well warm. Okay, let's preheat our water. Let's bring it to a boil. It's important that the water be very, very hot, even though it's powdered green tea, but it still needs to come to a boil. And I will put it in my ever again. Now I'm using a Celadon ever made by David Louvaux, a very beautiful one. Which has a very narrow and long spout. This is more in the style of the Song Dynasty. In these evers already existed during the Tang Dynasty, but at that time they were much shorter. Here the spout was much shorter and larger. And as the dynasty evolved, these spouts tended to be longer and longer to have a more and more precise pour in the bowl. Now this one is already very nice. I'm using another black glazed bowl by Michel Francois as my wastewater bowl. Oh, and I have this beautiful Celadon caddy tea jar in which I've put my green tea powder, which comes from Japan by my friend Florent Veug from Thé du Japon. Thank you, Florent. So this Celadon jar is quite special because it's actually from the Song or Yuan dynasty. So it's also a very old piece, maybe 600 years ago. But don't let these old numbers scare you a bit. Or if you feel you also want to impress people, just say, take a stone, say, this stone is at least 1 million years old, and you will have beaten us all with any wear that we might have, and it's much more antique than anything else. Okay, the water is boiling. I'm adding it again in my ever. spinning of the ball complete. Now I'm using this bamboo spoon to add my matcha or mocha in Chinese. Now comes the most difficult part, is the preparation. Now the big difference is with the Japanese way, is I'm going to perform the water, adding the water and whisking at the same time. But I'm starting first slowly. Okay. Now it comes here, and we have a beautiful bowl of Song Dynasty whisked green tea. Now it's going to be quite warm, so as you could see that the Song Dynasty, they liked things that are very simple in color, so either black with just a little bit of changes due to the way the glaze melts, so these are called partridge fur or hare furs. On the bowl here, or if it's completely brown, sometimes they will even call it a lion color. And sometimes to obtain a beautiful bowl, the potters in Jianyang would fire thousands of bowls in a dragon kiln and only keep two or three that were the best, that had the nicest transformations, the most harmonious shape, and keep these couple of bowls for the emperor. So they were doing a lot of experimentation for pottery making at that time to obtain these slight color transformations. They even obtained some blue color, and these are bowls that are currently owned by the Japanese Museum in Tokyo, if I remember well. And the other color that they liked a lot is Celadon during the Song Dynasty. So again, very pure color, no painting on it, just these little variations due to maybe the clay, like for Zhu Yao, for the Zhu kiln in Henan, which produced around 900 years ago, but for a very short period of time during the end of the Northern Song Dynasty, they produced really the most beautiful celadons that were ever made, and they had little shades of pink. And I actually can see also some shades of pink on this one by David Louvot. And it was fine that to get these little transformations, these little shades of pink, they were adding agate in the clay. So they were very skilled at that time, and the glaze was very, very thick. We can see that also here on that piece. Of course, for them, the reason they liked celadon so much already started in the Tang Dynasty. Lu Yu was speaking of the best clay, the best bowls coming from Yue. And during the Tang Dynasty also, there was Misetsu, a secret color porcelain. And this secret color, for a long time people were wondering, what is this secret color? What does it look like? And it's only when Farman Temple was renovated and the workers entered a hidden annex downstairs in the temple, that they found some relics from the Tang Dynasty with an inventory of all the wares, and one was this famous secret colored porcelain. And when they compared what we have in this inventory, they found that this secret color actually was a Yue celadon at that time. So the emperor wanted to keep it a secret, that so that he would be the only one to enjoy this beautiful celadon, so it was called a secret colored ware. So, and the reason that Chinese emperors loved celadon so much like this is because the color really reminds them of jade being the most precious stone in China, much more than diamonds, except nowadays of course. But jade has some supernatural also properties for the Chinese at that time. It was very, very precious. You could be used as money, with one disc of jade being valued as much as a whole village. So very, very expensive. And being able to for potters to make celadon that looks like jade is a bit akin to our alchemists of the Middle Age, who are trying to make gold with other metals. Okay, I think it's a bit cooled down. Let me drink that. Very fine.